from San Antonio.
Oh, my exes live in Texas. I got some oceanfront property in Arizona. That's Fort Worth, El Paracho. I was a young troubadour.
No one has captivated audiences quite like George Strait. He is the king of country music.
When I'm gone.
And the CMA Award for Entertainer of the Year goes to George Strait.
60 number one hits, 13 multi-platinum albums, a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame.
This is where the cowboy rides away.
But what you don't know about King George,
and my heart is sinking like the setting sun.
When the lights are no longer shining, once he puts down his guitar and the music stops, he gets back to his roots and kicks back on his ranch in South Texas, remembering the days of learning to hunt with his dad.
When I think back on the first time that I can remember hunting, I remember that my dad actually took me down to Dimmit County where he was raised. Back then it's pretty primitive, not like our deer blinds are today where they're pretty comfy. When I was allowed to have my own gun, I hunted with BB guns for years and still feel like I'm a pretty good shot with a BB gun. But you know, I'll never forget when my dad gave me my first .22 and I'd just take off and walk across the pasture, and I would. I'd shoot jackrabbits, cottontails, just anything I could find.
George spent many days as a kid on his dad's ranch hunting and fishing, and he's passed down his love for the outdoors to his son, Bubba.
What were you, Bubba, when I first took you hunting? Six or seven.
We'd sit in a deer blind together. We'd see something good, and he'd get up on my knee and
I'd wake up. He'd wake me up and say, get up off of the ground.
Those are some great memories, you know, and memories that I know he'll have with my new little grandson.
Yeah, I can't wait till he's old enough to where I can start teaching him, just like my dad taught me, teaching him about hunting and management and just all of the outdoor stuff that, you know, I was lucky enough to have my dad teach me.
Oh.
Those bird dogs are unbelievable, and we were talking about getting kids involved in hunting too. And I think it's just the coolest thing, and it would be the coolest thing for any kid, you know, old enough to hunt, just to go out and watch those dogs work. It's just so impressive. And
Very true.
That's just another, that got me hooked the first time I did it.
George is a third generation Texas rancher, and he's taken a keen interest in ranch management and conservation. He works with biologist Macy Ledbetter, planning for long-term solutions for the habitat of his ranch in Webb County.
This process has really helped me to appreciate Mr. Strait more and more. Everybody knows he can sing pretty well, but he's a great wildlife manager. He understands the processes.
You know, like I said, our quail population has just gone to almost zero. I know that's one of the focuses of Park City's quail, and that's really what this whole thing's all about, is to, you know, raise money for research.
Conservation is a very big word, big in the sense that it has so many meanings to so many different people. Conservation is very important to Mr. Strait and the Strait family. You know, it's third generations that hunt on that ranch right now.
Hunting's just a great way to kind of get away. Maybe you don't kill anything, but it's still great to come in and build a fire and sit around it and tell stories about what you did or didn't kill. Maybe sing a few songs, pass the guitar around.
Lie a little bit.
Tell lies.
Ladies and gentlemen, the 2014 T. Boone Pickens Lifetime Sportsman Award recipient, George Strait.
You've got to have an ace in the hole. A little secret that nobody knows. Life is a gamble game.
Wow. That was a nice presentation. Thank you guys very much. It's great to be here. And Boone, that was a special night for me at Augusta National, for sure. Anytime you can be at Augusta National for the night, it's a special time, believe me. And I enjoyed that very much. And just like I'm enjoying tonight, and I wish that I had more to say, but oh, wait. Some of this stuff really has already been said in the video, but I just want to, I wrote this on my computer, and I really don't, I mean, I know how to check emails and all that kind of stuff, but this was a struggle. But this is a great award, and I appreciate it, T. Boone, very much, and Park City's Quail, thank you so much for honoring me tonight. And I want to thank all of you guys out there and girls for coming out and supporting this. It's a great cause. We all believe in it. You know, I grew up my whole life enjoying the great outdoors, and whether it was hunting, fishing, or sometimes just riding horseback through the great brush country of South Texas, you know, I just loved it all. And I've hunted white-tailed deer forever. I mean, I just, like I said, my dad and was a big influence. My grandparents on both sides of my family were huge influences on me in hunting and fishing. My granddad on my mother's side taught me about hunting and fishing. He never had a ranch of his own, but he always had a hunting lease, and he always made sure that you know, there was a spot for me and my brother to go with him. And he always found those good stock ponds full of bass to take me, you know, and my brother and catch fish, and taught me how to do that and all of that stuff. And my papa on my dad's side, that's what we called him, he did have a ranch in Dimmitt County, and that's kind of where my dad, you know, taught me about whitetail hunting also, and where he gave me my BB gun, and and I would go out and shoot whatever I could with that until I got old enough for a 22, and me and my brother were really terrible at that time with those things, and you know, but we survived all that, and my grandmother, she loved to fish in those old stock ponds too, and she taught me how to fish with a cane pole with minnows. Yeah. Unbelievable. Great memories. And I remember back in those days also that we had an abundance of quail. Lots of quail. Bob whites and blues. Just everywhere. And I hunted them, you know, when I could as a kid, but we never had dogs or anything, so my papa taught me how to call quail, Bob whites, and I still love to do that today, and you can ask Bubba or Norma, whenever we see a covey of quail, I will try to call them, won't I? I will, won't I? Because, I mean, there's nothing like it. I mean, you call them up and you see them come up, you know, feathers all ruffled, wings spread out, ready for a fight. And that gets my blood pumping. For those of you who don't know how to do it, that's pretty much how you do it. I can call coyotes too, but I'm not going to embarrass you. So, In 1987, I bought my own ranch. And at that time, I had a lot of quail on it, a lot, just kind of like when I was a kid. And so I was able to afford some dogs, and I bought some dogs, and I had some great times hunting quail there. I mean, like Bubba said, there's nothing like seeing good dogs working, and you can talk to anybody that's hunted over dogs, and they'll tell you the same thing. Even if you don't hit one, just watching them fly away and glide on and on and finally land somewhere way away, and you don't know where they are anymore. But I mean, it's just, and believe me, I like to knock them down just as much as the next guy, but there's something about that that's awful beautiful also. And you know, you're gonna one day get another try at them. But over the years, the quail kind of started to disappear. It's just, and now today, you know, when I'm driving around the ranch, it seems like first the blue quails the Bob Whites kind of started dwindling, and every once in a while we'll still see Bob Whites, but the blue quail are gone. I haven't seen a blue quail down there in several years, and that's a shame. You know, everyone talks about the drought conditions, and I'm sure, you know, that's a big part of it. But I've seen rainy years also where, you know, you expect to see a little better quail crop than you see, and it's just, you know, there's got to be other factors involved, and I know there is. And I mean, I've started the feeding program and started trying to improve the habitat down on my ranch, you know, that's more favorable to the quail, and I'm hoping that will help some, but I still feel like there's a lot more that we can do. And that's what's important about these people that call themselves Park City's Quail. They're dedicated to finding out what the causes are for this decline and to bringing back our quail population to the numbers that we all remember and what they should be. And that's why I'm here tonight. And that's why I say everyone in this room deserves a huge round of applause for supporting this great cause. And I'm going to start it right here. For all you guys. Because if you weren't sportsmen, you wouldn't be here tonight. This is all made possible by you and people like you who care about our wildlife and our way of life as hunters and sportsmen. Nobody else is going to fix these problems but us and people like us. As ranchers and sportsmen, if we see a problem with our wildlife, we wonder what we can do to fix it. We're not just satisfied with, oh, well, I guess it's just going to be that way from now on. You know, that's just not the way we think. Because I think it can be the same, and I think we can fix it. Our wildlife depends on us to fix it. And so do our children and grandchildren. We want to see them have the same opportunities to enjoy this great outdoors, just like we did when we were young and kids. And with your help, we'll figure out that way to fix it and bring back our beautiful quail to a thriving population the way it should be, thanks to Park City's Quail. I want to thank you again for supporting Park City's Quail, and thank you all for this wonderful award. I appreciate it very much.
George, thank you very much. That was great.